Let's now talk to historian Xiao Chua on the importance of EDSA people power in present times. Good morning, Xiao. Good to see you again.
Makasaysayang umaga, Mike, at sa lahat ng ating kapamilya.
Mm-hmm. Prof. Chua, talk to us about the importance of education in terms of addressing disinformation and misinformation in the current age. I think much of the disinformation has been focused about the real incident, supposedly, during martial law. Is it really the case that education failed us? It failed in educating the youth now?
Well, we should reflect as teachers and historians and educators if we really did not do our best. For many of us, we did our best. Sometimes we have to look at how the curriculum, how it is designed. And EDSA people power is actually there. It's in grade 6 of the K+12. The only problem was we took away Philippine history in high school. So we have less history courses now. Teachers try their best to come out with content, to come out with evidence about what happened during martial law. The problem is, it's not just the educational system that is to be blamed, because many of the people actually changed their views about what happened 36 years ago because of the frustrations that we have had with how democracy turned out. And remember that it's a people power revolution. We always equate it with the restoration of democracy. But that democracy, of course, was hijacked by the elite. The judicial system was hijacked by them. The electoral system was hijacked by them. The political system was hijacked by them. And so people were frustrated that the crimes, the problems, I mean, of that EDSA, you know, we felt that EDSA will solve or democracy will solve, were not solved. Although people and our leaders tried. And so that is a bigger, shall we say, factor in why people, even if you put evidence in front of them, have changed their views about it.
So it's not just education, but to what extent do you think social media is a factor here? Because where do we get most of the information now? Some people are returning to TikTok, turning to YouTube to get the information. So I wonder if a whole discussion on martial law was placed in our textbooks when we're studying in elementary, would that still be a factor now? If you weigh both factors, yung libro, TikTok at YouTube, which is current, they can access it now. I mean, do you think it's really a fair fight?
Well, it's not a fair fight because we all know that there are social media operators. Mm-hmm. We all know that many of these creators, whether unwittingly or not, their posts were boosted by people who have the means and the capacity to influence social media algorithms. So that's another factor that we should, because a lot of us have made content. A lot of people who are actually very good at making content. Teachers, we just lecture and we appear in Zoom. But a lot of people have made great content. But many times, these are flooded by clickbaits, of course, because they know how to, they've done it in America before in the 2016 elections. They can target individuals and they can trigger their emotions through these videos. And they have mastered, actually. That's why we have to learn from them, actually, how to counter what they are doing.
And a big chunk of Biden's victory over Donald Trump was attributed to the opposition. At that time, the opposition really working with this tech company, social media platforms, in curtailing, for example, false information, flagging false information from former President Trump. Do you see that happening here? I'm not seeing any posts by Philippine politicians being flagged by Twitter as false.
Yeah, that's the problem, because when I mentioned even in an educational post the name of the German dictator from 1930s to 1940s, I always get punished for it. For 1 week, I cannot post. But you see all this Taliano gold and all this disinformation, misinformation. They don't get punished. You know? And the problem also is that although in YouTube they have started that when you have martial law content, there would be a Wikipedia article that clarifies what martial law was all about, that's a good start. But hopefully, because you know, we sometimes we are conflicted there because there is what we call freedom of expression, and sometimes we think that it is the freedom of these people to actually say these things. But sometimes I'm also thinking, you know, we should at least the problem is we are doing our best to answer. Mm-hmm. Because the only thing we can do is to answer, because we have freedom of expression, to answer these claims, these false claims. But the problem is, of course, again, the algorithms will be able to decide who's going to be read more.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And as a historian, Professor Chua, how do you feel history will write this chapter of our times? You have the son of a Philippine dictator possibly returning to Malacanang 36 years after their family was ousted out of power. How do you think history will see us?
Look, the 2022 elections, it's not just a political decision. You know, whatever the Filipino people decide will also be a referendum on what version of history that happened 50 years ago, because martial law is 50 years this year, and 36 years ago, what really happened. And sometimes it's not just the writing of history that decides the final outcome of how we view what happened in the past. You know, if if a Bongbong Marcos presidency will either succeed or not, that will also in many ways affect how people will view what happened in the past.
So Victor, go ahead.
So it's not just the victory, but also what will he do, and how will he run the country in the next few years? That will also decide if he does well, then maybe we will forget that people power was a good thing. But we really do not know. We historians are finding it difficult also to do hindsight. But we also see that there are deeper implications on how we see ourselves, because remember that people power is one of the rare victories of a unified Filipino. And if we cancel that event, ano pa ang matitira sa atin? What will be left of us?
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Professor Xiao Chua. I guess we'll have to wait for history to be written, but right now we write our own history. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you so much.